everyone. Happy to have you here for another episode of Legacy Matters. Our show is growing, and the lives and legacies of the people around us have taken on a new importance as we take stock of what is most precious to us. As always, our show will focus on building and preserving your legacy, the importance of community, and the telling of stories we find amusing. Thanks for joining us. Now, enjoy the show. Anyway, hi, you two.
Yeah,
hi.
I said hi.
Did
you?
Yeah. You did.
You talked right over. Yeah. It's all
you
good.
Did.
Hi. Well, welcome.
I mean,
hi.
And I'm sure our listeners are super excited to hear all this, but when in the editing process, I've been trying to figure out a place that'll transcribe these for us. Because you should have a transcript of your show, right? And then you can actually have AI like help you with generate the show notes and all of that stuff.
Right.
And this show is untranscribable.
Oh, I bet.
There's no way.
No. It's like it recognizes four voices all at once and it just puts it into a big glob. And it's like, you have 16.
Can I be honest? Instead of getting a transcript, you get a word cloud.
That's better. That should go.
That's the way this one
works.
That's
the way it is. And people can feel like, I feel like I was there. It was one big ramble. I'm in.
That's pretty much what it would look like, yes.
Just random question marks every once in a while. Like, I don't know. Is this the end of a sentence?
Choose your own adventure.
I like it.
Oh,
host,
I like that a lot.
Host 15 said this at this point. Anyway.
Exactly.
Let's start this off the right way. We've got Comedy Corner Underground. Thank you very much.
God bless them. Yep. Love you guys.
Best place ever.
God. What else can you say, Mark?
It's great.
So
they're really ramping it up too. They're having more shows Wednesday nights. I was down here the other Wednesday night. They've got shows going on Wednesdays, Thursday, Friday. So it used to be just Friday night open mic and a show. Now it's four nights a week.
That's awesome.
I looked at their website.
We're probably responsible for that.
It's
all of this press.
People are like, we should totally go check it out. High five.
Way to go. You're totally right. Totally right. Yes. It is us.
Yep.
That is how important.
Right.
And yes, it's important.
You know what? We'll take it.
It's a lot more convincing when we don't laugh at afterwards.
It's funny because I wanted to say something stupid.
I was laughing at something earlier.
You will. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's all fine. I'll say stupid stuff later. Anyway.
And we're here, but... We're also sponsored by people.
We are sponsored.
We are.
And we'll so anyway, Comedy Corner, thank you.
Great.
It's very, very nice of you to let us use the space. And
yeah.
It does. I love the fact that it's so intriguing to people when they have guests here and they've never been here and they come down and they're like,
what?
There's a fucking room down there. And it's kind of
cool.
Like,
I like it. Secret.
Yeah.
Speakeasy of comedy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's intentionally... sort of
scary?
Early 80s New York underground comedy
Absolutely.
Club kind of vibe.
That's exactly what it was from.
I went to their website and like they have some snazzy looking pictures of like people being here. So it's not when you sit here and do it in what we're doing, it doesn't necessarily feel like there are people here, but there are people who use this space.
Are you seeing
comedy.
Them now?
Yeah.
A ghost.
Yeah.
The ghost of
down here.
This is an old building.
It is.
So anyway, all good. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Comedy Corner. Anyway.
Yeah,
Andrea Storley and her shop's Nail Ninja.
Correct.
Yes.
I've had three or four people reach out to me and say, I bought gift certificates or I booked an appointment. So our advertising does actually work.
Yay.
And it's great
guaranteed to get three out of four people in there.
I think you meant three or four, not three.
I said what I said.
Yeah.
I'm sticking with it.
Our advertising.
It's early.
Exactly.
It's early.
It's expensive as shit, but you will get two or three people coming to your store.
Yeah.
That's hyper Minnesotan.
If we're being honest.
I'm not supposed to say that stuff.
It's fine.
Yeah, no, actually, the advertising works. And the reason it works is because you are our loyal listeners.
Yeah.
And we do have a few. It's hard to tell who's listening and who's not and all of that. But I know that people do listen to the show. I know it's not millions of people.
Is there still that guy in Boise?
but people all over the world, probably bots of some sort. Anyway, they do enjoy the show. And
we
loyal.
Enjoy them listening.
We love it. And you're loyal to the people who support us.
Yeah.
So I appreciate that. And yes, do go check out Nail Ninja.
Yeah.
That was the whole point there.
Yep.
We'll slip the
tomorrow. We're recording the new ad. We'll slip it into our shows. But in the meantime, thank you, Nail Ninja, for actually supporting the show.
Being
cool. $2. I would also like to mention Divine Fox Productions, which is now the production company producing this show, which is owned by me.
Right.
So, like, total self plug here. But in this modern world, there is whether you want to start a podcast for the purpose of becoming famous, which I think you might be a little bit nutty if you think you're going to get famous off of it.
Yeah.
If you are creating a brand of yourself, or if you are promoting an idea or a project or a company, it is not a bad idea to do these things. And in fact,
wait, is that why we're doing it?
Audio, video production. We are.
I don't think so.
Back there. Well, it used to be that, but okay, now we're just doing it for fun. But anyway, these things do actually work, and we've got a studio. You can look us up online.
Wait,
Divine Fox Productions.
There's a studio.
There's a mobile. This is the mobile studio, Mark. And then there's an actual studio space in the North Loop in Minneapolis that you can go to that Mark will not go to because it's too fancy. And he's
bougie.
I'm somewhat slighted that we would have another space.
No, not at all. Because this is the best space. I'm glad for you to have another place to go play.
I mean, could you get more passive aggressive?
Do I have to separate you two?
I know.
I'm going to sit between you.
We're like 48.
I wouldn't suggest that.
We're 48 minutes into this podcast.
I'm scared.
And we have a guest.
And we have not yet introduced that guest. Yep. So can
that
we
is
please,
so abnormal that never happens.
We had a few listeners and we lost most of them.
Nah.
So whoever stuck around, thanks for sticking around. We have a guest.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. I'm going to have to put it in the show notes that you got to skip forward to 8 minutes in.
8:32.
That's when the guest starts. Anyway.
Hi.
Oh my gosh. And I said it before. I know it's Jen.
Yes.
And then I was like, I think I know your last name. And I said it. And now this is what happens to me.
I'm going to
screwing it up.
All right.
It makes me nervous, but I like screwing it up. But is it Gilhoi?
It is. Oh, you got it right.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
Yes.
God, I was kind of hoping you would
notice how you didn't look
below
to
that.
Me.
No, I looked off into the universe as I said it. I looked down and I kind of closed my eyes and I focused really tightly in on like, bring it to me, universe, please. Jen Gilhoi.
Yeah. Welcome.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank
and what
you.
Brings you in?
Exactly.
I think a previous guest, maybe.
Yeah.
I know.
That's been happening now.
Yeah. Yeah. Who is that previous guest?
Glenn Auerbach.
And why did he say we should talk to you?
Well, he is
Sauna Times.
The Sauna Godfather is when I was first introduced to him years ago. I was like, wow.
Oh.
He's
does he go by that?
Well,
he's probably got a t-shirt that says it.
I don't know.
I like it.
Yeah. I don't know if he actually accepts that title, but it has been given to him.
I feel like that could be a really nice fit.
Yeah.
The reason I ask, we have to get into your story and everything, but the reason I ask is because someone suggested that I should brand myself as the podcast guy. And I'm like, hell no. I cannot stand the idea of that one bit.
No.
And I don't want to be the Godfather either, but I can imagine from his perspective, the sauna guy is not as cool as the sauna Godfather.
Absolutely.
Like, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's earned it. Well, in Sauna Times is when Glenn and I first started kind of talking about the content that we might want to put out in terms of like my story. So we collaborated on a story about a year and a half ago, and that went into the Sauna Times.
Wow.
And we can share. We can talk a little bit about what that was. But
I mean,
what did it happen in a sauna?
Actually, the story was more about the experience of sauna and why it's so meant so much to me to find that sense of community and space. And he had already been experiencing sauna and doing it everywhere.
Yeah.
And I came to the current, like, modern day experience of sauna, which often includes cold immersion.
Right.
Through sobriety, really.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So we're going to go there.
We're going to go there. We're good at that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hold on 1 second as I listen around me and I wonder what in God's name is going on with the air conditioning or the heating
system. I don't
think
anyone else can hear it.
No, they can and they can't. It doesn't really matter, but I love it.
It's throwing you off?
I just want to hear it for a second.
Oh.
You know what?
Yeah, it's like
they're
like
different the podcasts done, for that. That's done, not this.
Oh, it's not one
yeah,
of those.
Yeah, those weird noise. Ones.
Yeah, it done got all clanky, yeah, but it's fine. No, it doesn't. It doesn't affect the show.
Yeah, I can tell you're not distracted.
Good. I can take it out in noise reduction. I just really wanted to hear
the steam
of
the sauna in the background.
Yeah, you can lie and say that's exactly what it is.
It was like it kicked in.
We're taking the steam right now.
Yeah,
yeah.
Fire up the sauna.
It kicked in right at the right moment. Okay, so let's go back to the start though. Jen Gilhoi, that's the name.
Right.
Got yes, it.
Yeah, that's the first one.
Pronounced correctly.
Are you from around here?
I am from southwestern Minnesota. Small town of about 4,000.
Jackson.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I guess Jackson.
Wait. You did some pre-research.
I did not.
What?
Everyone
who
says they're from southwest Minnesota in a small town, I have so many different weird connections to Jackson.
Oh, my God, it's the thing. So I just met with my high school friends, Kobe Dinah, last week, and we were just saying that it always comes back to Jackson. I'm like, Jackson. It does not. Other small towns have the same experience.
I was going to say Edgerton, because that's where the people I know.
Nope.
Yep.
No.
Not that one. Not that one.
It's true. I mean, I hear it all the time, but of course I'm biased because that's my small town.
Right.
But that's very reaffirming that you have experienced the Jackson connection.
I had a bunch of friends in college. Like we grew up in Elk River, Kate and I.
Okay.
And we've been friends ever since high school. And there's an Elk River connection. And then I've got people from Big Fork. And then I've got people from Bemidji and Minneapolis. And then Jackson.
And then Jackson.
And then Jackson.
Jackson and
which
and
makes
then
sense.
And then Rochester. Like those are the big ones though.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
Never thought of that. Like where my communities are.
Yeah. Jackson. Yeah, there's a cohort of Jacksonians. Jacksonians.
Jacksonians.
Yeah, there you go. That works.
Yeah. Jacksonians that I know. Jacksonites.
Yeah.
From
Oh my God, is that what this podcast is all about?
Making up names
so far.
Add those to the Urban Dictionary for you.
Never know.
Anyway, so you're from Jackson. So are you super weird?
No.
Because everyone I know from Jackson is super weird.
I left early. I knew I wanted
to get
I'm just kidding. I'm kidding too.
You are weird. Okay, good. All right. Okay. No, Jackson is funny. There is a different it's just a different cultural place when you grow up down in Jackson.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not bad.
What county is that?
Jackson County.
Really?
Yeah.
That freaking makes sense.
So we have a history of...
But it's the county seat, too.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Yes.
Same. A heavy metal. There's...
there's a lot of musicians.
There's a lot of musicians that
I thought we were talking about mining. Okay.
And so the surprise is that I'm not a country music fan, although we're
thank
in...
Thank God for small favors.
You know, like just the rural setting, but...
I almost had to walk out and leave.
Mm-hmm. No. So you're a heavy metal fan? I mean, I grew up on that.
Yeah.
And it felt very natural to me to just go to a high school party where there'd be a band playing.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
is it like in an airstrip? Because I feel like in small towns, you have weird areas that you party in. There's an airstrip by Rochester.
Cornfields, mostly.
Why not?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, cornfields.
We had that.
Yeah.
That's the very Minnesota.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you think the kids do that anymore?
Yes.
Cornfield party?
God, I hope so.
Well, they don't.
Yeah.
I mean.
Well, not in Minneapolis, no.
I asked you, do you think they do? And you said, we know they do.
We don't, but there's hope.
Know. There's hope, yeah.
Yeah. I hope that
sounds
sort of social interaction is still going on because it's super fun.
Cow
put your phone
tipping,
down and go into a field.
Catching a buzz off a tire fire.
There's a lot of trouble you can get into. I mean, that's what you're, as a teen, you're seeking to find that, right?
Right.
What do you do in a small town?
I opened up a can of worms.
Yeah, if you haven't woken up in a cornfield the next day, you haven't really partied.
Yeah.
I hear you.
To be from Rochester, we had the big corn cob
water tower. I love that thing.
So that was always a threat to climb that sucker.
If you're, my Big Fork friends are like, no, it's the forest. It's like a clearing in the forest. Mm. They don't have the cornfields. But anyway.
Right.
Anyway.
Yeah. Well, they missed out.
Yeah. No, that's all good. So you grew up down there. You what led you to being in this basement with us?
Oh, my God.
That's a few decades.
So, from a cornfield to here, I think there's a slight transition.
We're going
to
try and just
jump right in.
Because I know you've got a story to tell. You've got a thing that you're doing or
everybody
something,
right? Everybody does, right?
A few things.
Yeah. But I want to get to those, but I'm just, it's just sort of the backstory of.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, growing up in a small town was amazing. I loved it. But I also was really ready for something big and different. I knew that I wanted to travel abroad and experience, like, you know, the world. I was drawn to Rome, Italy. So one of the reasons I chose my school that I went to in the city, St. Thomas, was because they had a program in Rome.
Yeah.
Honestly, that was my college decision. I was like, Buena Vista, which is like in a cornfield in Iowa.
Yep.
Or Minneapolis, which was connected to Loyola, Chicago. Yeah. And I could, so I saw those kind of connections immediately and chose my education based on I wanted an urban
and you
environment.
Were a good enough
and I wanted
student.
To travel. I was a good student.
You were a good enough student to get to have that opportunity.
Yeah, I really was.
Okay. Mm-hmm. See, these are things, these little nuggets. Mm-hmm. So, from Jackson, liked
heavy metal.
Heavy metal.
Right.
And smart student. All right. We got a couple. We got
those
a couple.
Three.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, this is, now you've been labeled and defined.
Now, exactly. Like, now we know she thanks you now for that story. Yeah. So,
well, cool.
That's all there is, right? Well, this has been fun.
Yay. Been good time. Night, Minneapolis.
We'd like to thank our sponsors.
Sweet.
We're out of here.
We told you it'd be easy.
Oh, no, that's not the way this goes.
No.
Anyway, so you I would assume then by that you went and did some traveling.
Rome.
Yeah, went to Rome my junior year. Nice. And came back and tried to break up with a boy who insisted I had reverse culture shock. And I'm like, no, I really have been trying to get away from you for quite some time.
Really, it's just you.
It really is just you. I tried to, you know, letters, like write letters about maybe it's time. And
No, one's good
there. It's you.
He picked you up from the airport and was like, how we doing?
Did. He did.
Oh, yeah. No.
No one's good at being broken up with.
Mm.
I mean, it's hard. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
That's what I hear.
Do you feel like you did a pretty good job of trying to ease him into it?
No. He just, I don't know, did not listen. He drove 5 hours to surprise me and tell me that
the last surprise you wanted.
Right?
Oh, my God.
Huge. Wait a minute, though. Ladies, isn't there some romance in that he was so young and he was in love?
You're not into him.
Yet. I'd actually kind of moved on. And my friends were like, oh, my gosh, he's here.
I think that script has been flipped and is like, that's called stalking. Before it was
'80s
movies.
Oh my gosh.
And now
I was years ago. But
I mean,
it's true.
I mean, do you understand from the, we'll just give you a little bit of the male perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All of the movies we would have watched growing up were like, you got to go after her, dude.
Yeah. Right,
you know, like it was our responsibility to be persistently fucking weird.
You go back and watch that stuff, you're like,
according
you should
to the
have
movie,
been arrested.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Like, it doesn't play well these days.
No, it does not.
But that's all we had to work with back then.
That's right. We didn't know any better.
Yeah.
We didn't know any better.
Not every
awkward. It was
not
just
every
really
one of those
awkward.
Experiences oh, ended God. In the police station.
No.
Some of them.
Just the
and
fun
maybe
ones.
That's maybe that's why it changed. You know, maybe it needed to change.
It needed to change.
This isn't right.
Well, I came back from that experience 4 months in Rome, totally empowered, totally enlightened. Like that is
so
not
you
my
had
life.
Changed.
Mm-hmm.
Was he from
Jackson? I was drinking like fancy cappuccinos and my friends were like, what happened?
Wow.
Like,
oh, you were that girl.
You got judged by your friends when you came home and they were like,
did you have just a little bit of an accent? Just a little?
Yes.
Okay.
And I tried to, you know, keep the Italian learning and language going.
Yes. And how long were you there?
I was there 4 months.
So you're going to pick up the accent for sure in 4 months.
Yeah.
No.
Flat out no.
Let's say I have a friend or two who, you know, came back from their experiences abroad and they're like, rolling cigarettes.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Hello.
Absolutely.
That one resonates.
Yeah.
Do you know who I might be talking about?
I mean, probably more than one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And they're like, I can't believe you Americans anymore.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I can't even get a good cappuccino.
You're 20-ish. I mean,
so was this like maybe the 90s?
Yes.
In
it was.
College?
Yeah. Like 93-ish.
It
all makes sense.
Checks out. Checks out.
Like it.
Yeah. I love the Italian language, though. It's just beautiful. It was hard to come back. It was harsh. Like, coming back in January and being dropped into, like, J term for my last semester.
Oh, that's the wrong time of year to come back.
Really depressing. Yeah,
I think I went through
some major depression.
Oh, for sure.
And there is some culture shock, but that's not that he was.
It has nothing to do with him.
Move on.
No, but that's the hard part to explain to him. He's like, because from his perspective, to be fair,
everything is about him.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
So yeah, you not being there right. anymore.
Probably listen to the Say Anything soundtrack as he's driving there.
He's yeah, he's like, I got the boombox.
Yeah, he's ready.
I'm ready.
Maybe
to
made you a mixtape yeah. Oh, yeah. for the ride
oh,
home?
100%. Oh, I got mixtapes yep. while I was yes. in Rome. Yep. And I was yeah. just like, oh, yeah. yep. This is, yeah. And just talking, Not even like mixtapes of music, just like, yeah.
Oh, that actually is a little disturbing, actually.
Yeah.
That's fun, a little disturbing. Fun to hear this from the other perspective.
Yeah, my BFF spent a year in the Netherlands and Germany after we graduated here. We graduated in 93. And so
high school, that is. Yeah.
I mean, that's how we would communicate because we had so much to talk about. Mm-hmm. We would fill up.
Yeah,
like both sides of a 90-minute cassette, and
I
might take you a week to record all the good stuff and then throw it in the mail, mm-hmm. and that's how mm-hmm. we would write letters to each other.
I recently had a friend from California. I was writing to her as I was in Rome. She sent all of my letters back to me and was like, "Wouldn't you love to have these?"
My
and
God, it
was,
yes.
Yeah. I mean, drinking stories. So we'll also get into
stuff that you probably forgot.
Drinking history,
right?
Things you
forgot
about.
Jen, you need
about.
To know. There's a second half. And the second half is where we get into all the other stuff. This is just us figuring out kind of who you are. Somebody.
Okay, so you're putting pause on that.
Not necessarily.
Well, you can talk about whatever you want, but you have time. We give people time.
Okay. Great.
These shows go anywhere from 15 minutes to 4.5 hours.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. I don't know if you know what you signed up for. No, but it's fun for us because I think a little bit of that backstory, like, okay, so we get it. We're from that kind of area or era as well. So
some of us are.
I was putting you in there kindly.
We're in the same basket.
I know. It's a big basket. It's all good.
It's like a hot air balloon basket.
We're going to throw the ballast over. That's that guy. Anyway, all good. Okay, so you come back. You got the puppy dog trailing you with this, like, I love you. And then...
Because you land and he expects you to just be ready to re-engage in the relationship and your mind
couldn't be
farther away from that car ride.
How do I get out of this car?
But sorry to break it to him.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that he just got about 8 minutes of airtime.
I know.
He's not from Jackson.
Yes.
It's close.
Finally, he's like, so that's what happened.
Yeah. No, there is a sweet story. There is a sweet story of coming around with him. Just to, you know, Facebook is just like you keep.
Did you reconnect and make friends?
Yeah.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah.
That's I like that.
Yeah. It's really good.
Return the tapes.
Yep.
Yeah. Did you give them all the tapes?
Oh, like,
I never listen to these. You can have them back.
And I keep everything. Why don't I have those?
Oh, because you don't see the importance in preserving things when you're young. That's fine. And then you go back and listen to them, and there's a 90% chance you're like, holy shit, I got to burn this.
No one can ever hear this.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Dear diary, I'm an idiot. Yeah. Burn diary.
Burn.
Yeah. Why?
Yeah. Gee, I was a little self-centered when I was 14.
Gee.
How'd that happen?
Good thing that's changed.
Yeah. Oh, Mark. Ouch. Anyway, so Jen, what else? What else we got? Okay, so you're in college. You come back. You got this new pretentiousness that you learned in Italy.
Yep. You leaned into. Yes. You're like, I'm all in.
Yeah. Yep.
Absolutely.
That's good. Yeah. And then what?
It's not bad.
Let's see. Then I'm living in Uptown.
Mm.
Loved that era in my 20s. Of course, there was three places. Well, I was going
to
mention. There's
Old
Filio,
Chicago,
right? Old Chicago or the Peanut Bar, right?
I fucking checked your ID at Old Chicago. That's
checked IDs at Filio, so it was fine.
Yeah. So, you know, again, just like meet up with people. We had like an answering machine where we would check in and like call in and be like, where are you going to be tonight? It was only really three locations, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was so fun in my 20s.
That was how you limited the likelihood that you'd be disconnected or lost from someone for very long was, I checked the entire bar. They're not at this one. Well, they're going to be at the other one or the other one.
There's a sense of adventure.
I love that. Now it's like, you're crying because you can't get a hold of them. Like they're just, they're right around there. Somewhere. They're go find them.
Yeah.
We had to deal with all that.
We had to deal with that. There was a payphone.
Yeah.
And I remember my now ex-husband, we were married for 20 years, but our first initial date was he called me from that payphone and said, come down to the you know, uptown, the Williams.
Williams.
Oh, right. That's, come down and meet me here.
Williams, and not old Chicago.
No, it was
I don't even know where I worked.
Yeah.
You were at Williams.
You were at Williams.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, okay. So you were there. Yeah. You probably witnessed the whole thing.
We were at Filio.
So you played, I remember Williams, you play touch the back wall. You'd be up at the top bar, and you'd see how long it would take you all the way down, touch the back bar, and come all the way back up through the crowd.
Really?
We were
bored. Some nights that takes forever.
It takes forever.
Unless you know a bouncer who can just like cut a path through that.
Or swim through peanut shells or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yuck.
So a payphone, right?
Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah. No, but those were good. I mean, there was a self-reliance or a, like, there was, oddly, almost more connection with people in a certain way before we got so damn connected.
It felt intentional
people
to meet
used
people.
Yeah,
you had to talk. Like, you had to make such an effort to actually see people and talk to them. And you'd have to go
God
out.
God forbid you made a plan and you stuck to it.
Yeah.
And everybody met at 7 at the place that you said you should meet at.
Yes.
Did that ever happen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, or so if you were late, like everyone was like, okay, well, we're not leaving until so-and-so shows up.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry, couldn't find a place to park. It's uptown.
Yeah.
Right. Versus now arriving somewhere and you're texting, I'm 2 minutes late. I'm here. I'm there. Yeah. And I still have people that I meet up with that are just texting me their whereabouts all the time. I'm like, it's okay.
I'll know when you walk to the table that you're here.
Right, and that'll be exciting. Let's just let that happen.
Yep.
Maybe we need to make a movement around, you know?
So just stop telling people where you are.
I'll be there when I get there.
I'll see you when I see you.
The guy who sends a text coming in hot.
Right. I know, she got you.
No, I know, but it made me think about it. That's what made me think about it. Yep. I knew I was going to get here right around 5:30. Like, I knew I wasn't actually going to be late.
Right.
And you were sitting
I had the same thing when I texted y'all. I was like, I'll be there just arriving around 5:30.
But did you really
need to do that?
No, let's just not do this. All right, future guests, if you're listening to this, just show up.
Just show up.
5:30-ish.
Make us sweat a little bit.
To be honest, Kate and I don't find out anyway, so you're only really talking to Sam.
5:30-ish on Tuesday, show up.
Yes.
All right, let's do this. Okay, so. So now you're living the life in God, 90s everybody. Uptown was, that was a different place.
I also lived in Uptown
in
my 20s. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
That was fun. It was a fun time.
24th and DuPont, 23rd and Emerson, 33rd and Irving. Like, I was all over that place.
He and I were out last weekend, and one of the guys we were out with, a longtime Uptown friend of ours, was suggesting that, you know, you could somehow bring some of that back. And my thoughts on it were, no, you can't, because you cannot recreate the safeness the weirdness and just how
safe.
It was like everybody looked like they were like somewhat nutty or something, but at the end everyone was just out having a good time. You're like, there was now it's gotten weird. It's just different.
Yeah, it's different.
You can't recreate. Chaos. Yeah.
No. Yeah, that's what it feels like.
Yeah, and I can't say that it's a bad place. It'll reinvent itself. But you can't go backward, is what I'm saying. You can't get back to that era when it was really fun.
Right. Can I just say Kindo's spring rolls?
Sorry.
Deep tracks.
Okay. Yeah.
Deep tracks.
Okay.
Go back there.
Islesman and Coffee Co. I lived right by there.
It's a good place to be.
All right, so you spent your 20s.
Hell yeah.
Well misspent them in Uptown area, and then what? Because we got to get to the, like, where you're at.
Oh, yeah. Let's see.
So there's 15 then years.
What? Yes, so.
Went by in a, you know, blink of an
dating,
eye.
Dating, a few relationships, and then met my ex, but my husband in probably when I was like 28. 29, and at that time,
that seems reasonable.
Everyone, like, I was like late to the, getting married. It was like everyone was already doing that.
Yeah.
And it was just like, all right, I felt like I had to kind of find that person, settle down, do the whole family thing. Didn't really question that. So, I found someone. We dated for 3 years, got engaged in Paris, and then came back.
Why wouldn't you?
Yeah, was a good move.
Well done.
And then married when I was 30.
Then moved into
a house. Very fancy,
like mowing the lawn and fucking taking care of the garden and all that shit.
Yeah, none of that for me.
Yeah.
I'm like, no.
Well, one of you was doing it.
Yeah.
All right. And then, like, do you feel like that adequate?
Okay, this is I'm waiting for this.
We're 30 minutes in, so I just want to exactly. I want to get it's through the like yeah. who the hell are you?
Well, exactly.
You know, because yeah, that's the this is what we do is bring people yeah. in, and sometimes people launch right into their, you know, their current endeavor, their right. thing or whatever. Mm-hmm. And
it seemed appropriate
yeah. to kind of yeah. go through, since there are a lot of shared connections. You
oh
got,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Connections in time and places,
yep. yeah, yeah.
you
right.
know, that
right.
that we're all familiar right. with these things, and we presume that our audience, which is largely made up of teenagers, because they love this show.
You can't you even say that with it. A straight
you almost
face.
Got through it. So
funny. They don't know yeah. we're so actually talking about. Time. No teenager they're listens at, to our show.
Trying to find their no. grandma to at, fact check that.
Yeah, they're Googling Uptown, and they're like, what is yeah. this Uptown place?
Hey, have you guys seen this? Have you fallen on this like historical record of Minneapolis podcast that I listen to?
Geriatric people.
Unintentionally, that's what you have
yeah.
created.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, good unintentionally. Lord.
Nice.
All right. Well, I mean, I'm just trying to figure out if it's a good time to take a break.
Yeah.
Take a break.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's midway through.
Right. I think
it's,
what do we do? What do you usually do?
We usually take a break yeah, around break. Now. Yeah. Though we do have some guests who, like at, you know, 43 minutes in, I'm like, hold on a second. I'm going to put my hand up. We need to take the break.
Yeah.
No, it seems like if we went through adequately sort of dragged you through the memory of
yeah,
your
exactly
youth,
like,
you seem to throw it out there.
Yeah.
Then we could take our little break and we can come back and talk about other things.
All right, let's do it.
Next step. Sounds good. Oof, man. Break time.
Save the world, it could be up to you. Wait a second, wait a minute, and we're through.
Kinetic Legacy is the company that powers the Joe Contractor app. Their unique platform blends the good parts of social tech with their one-of-a-kind data organizing system, giving communities large and small a safe, private space to stay connected and to keep information and memories organized. If you and your community have a shared purpose or passion and are looking for a better way to stay connected, contact Kinetic Legacy today at kineticlegacy.us. Find out how groups from contractors to campers, tribal communities, unions, and alumni organizations are finding their way to meaningful new spaces in this increasingly digital world. Again, that's kineticlegacy.us.
If you're a fan of the show, you know that I love the outdoors. Several years ago, I stopped by a small, independent, and very much American-made little shop in Clarissa, Minnesota, called Battle Lake Outdoors. They sell the best quality canoeing packs, hunting packs, firefighting packs, and much more. Check them out at battlelakeoutdoors.com and use the coupon code LegacyMatters for a 5% discount on your order. Again, that's battlelakeoutdoors.com.
Hey, this is Kate. Visit a Nail Ninja salon and you will find yourself in a salon experience like something you've only imagined could exist or that you thought only existed in places far cooler than Minnesota. Nail Ninja feels like the unholy union of a badass tattoo joint and the International Space Station. The best equipment, exceeding state regulations for sterilization, comes together with the absolute best artists in the industry. No more boring shit. Seriously, this is a different experience and one you don't want to miss out on. Book an appointment today online at nailninjampls.com.
Wonder Woman Construction is a Minneapolis-based, woman-owned residential and commercial construction and electrical company. Lori and her team pride themselves on their commitment to long-term, green, and sustainable building practices, and they apply their deep understanding of building science to each project they take on. They are dedicated to the complete satisfaction of every client. One more thing that you absolutely cannot miss about Wonder Woman Construction is the fact that every employee loves what they do and truly enjoys working with each other. The best projects are those that are done by happy people, and Wonder Woman Construction is full of happy people. Visit WonderWomanConstruction.com to get started on your happiest project ever.
Save the world, it could be up to you. Wait a second, wait a minute, and we're through.
All right.
And we're back.
Yeah, there you go.
I've always wanted to say that.
Oh, yeah, just get in there.
Okay.
Really?
And we're back. Second half.
You said that?
It's so cheesy, dude.
I like it.
Look at the smile on my face.
I know. You really enjoyed it.
Cheesy.
Ah, that's good.
So we're back with
second half, Jen Gilhoi.
Oh, he did it. I didn't think he'd get it.
That's
I didn't think he'd get it four times in a row. He got it right.
You were so focused proud on of you. Just,
like, I have to focus each and every time. Yeah, I have to go like into a different part of my brain and be like, just look at the word. You saw it on like, the thing.
When we have an anniversary show, I want to just do clips of Sam trying to get people's names.
Wow. Right. That's all it
is. Like just a big montage.
Of yes. Mispronunciation.
So our large.
Writing that down.
Cohort of teenage listeners will watch the anniversary show.
Right. Yes. Yep, they will love it.
They love the show.
They're going to stay up late for
it. We're so cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're not.
I mean, they
could
listen to it anytime they want, but they're going to stay up late.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, don't get lost in the details.
I never do.
Stay up late every night. My teens are up. I get texts at 1 a.m.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what is this new high school thing where you don't have to show up at 8 a.m. Like school starts then, but if you have a class, like a study hall.
Yeah.
You don't need to show up till 10:30.
I found out what block days are.
Soft rules.
A
block day. Oh, I only have two classes today. Oh, they're each 2 hours long. It's like, what?
It's basically college when you're like a junior. You're already experienced.
We had that. Just one class, though, was a 2 hour block.
Well, you had that one small school because you're all in one, the little.
Yeah, in a one room school.
I'll tell you.
Schoolhouse rock.
I split my time between
Minnesota.
Between a couple of different districts, though. Elk River, and most of what I know from Minnesota schools, this stuff doesn't happen. Okay. Down in Madison, in Wisconsin, in McFarland, like. It was an open campus, though, for high school. Mm-hmm. And so if
kind
you didn't
like
have
relationships in college,
if, that's different.
Well,
different.
Oak River kids were not trustworthy enough to experience open campus. Therefore, we were on lockdown. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
But so, I mean, people would they might show up for the 3 or 4 hours they actually have school that day and the rest of the day. They don't. So, I mean, is that sort of what's going on now? Where are your kids in school?
Washburn. And then my daughter is now in college at the U of M. So,
hello.
Well, that answers some other questions.
Trying to get them ready for college. It's
go
weird.
For power. Yeah. And go for power.
How old are these children?
They are 18.
One's college age.
My son's 18 and my daughter's 20.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, I've got 16 and 14. Just about 17 and 15, but they're both at Roosevelt.
You know, you got another one too, right?
Yeah.
My favorite?
Yeah.
Well, I just was.
Oh, just the high school age ones. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Okay.
Got it.
Yeah, the other one. I mean, she's just the most precious, best thing there ever was in the whole world.
Yeah.
And how old?
7.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
clearly
in charge.
Yeah. In charge.
I mean, she's it's just as the world. And the other two, the older two. And I've made this joke before, but I forget their names at the moment. But they're
forget their names. But
they're boys.
The boys.
Nice.
Yeah.
Forget.
Just kind like, of blend into the background. Yeah.
If they ever listen to the show, which I wouldn't expect my own children to. God.
They're teens, though. That's our captive audience.
One of my daughters did say, "Oh, I listened to it." I go, "How long?" She goes, "Both minutes." I'm like, "All right, fair enough."
That's the extent of it.
Yeah. So, okay. And so you're,
so you've been in Minnesota for quite a long time.
Yeah.
You've enjoyed it.
Yep. And a marriage that you were in for a long time with children is ending.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we won't get into, details about that or whatever, but it sounds, I hope it's amicable. I just like it when people, end relationships, long-term relationships, especially with children, just putting a plug in, to the whole entire world.
Right.
Yeah.
If you've had children with someone, believe it or not, you're always going to have a relationship with them.
Figure it
out.
You
just have to decide whether it's going to be a good one or a bad one.
Yeah.
And so even if you just don't like that person very much anymore, you better figure out how to have a relationship with them
because
you got kids.
That's right.
So that's not directed at you. That's the world.
That's everyone. The world.
That was a PSA from Sam, everybody.
Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Just
thanks.
Sam.
I just wish people understood that and didn't do so much fighting.
Right.
You know, like, what's the point?
What's the point?
I can't stand it when you, you've got a friend who's like, "Oh, I hate that bitch." It, like, you mean the one you were married to for 20 years that you loved so much for so long?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
don't do that to me. I hate that stuff.
Yeah. I hate that. It happens
so
a lot.
So you moved on.
It does.
So we've all moved on from that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, people, there's no point in any
of it. There's no point.
Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. So so the kids are heading off to college and end of high school, and that's moving on. And then, okay, so what are you doing these days?
Well, the probably for the last 10 years, I would say my journey in my life have been tied into getting sober, like figuring out how to be sober. I call myself sober necessary, which means to me that drinking alcohol and my personality type and how I misused alcohol just didn't mix. Yeah. So I had to cut it out around age 40, and it was really hard. Yeah. Really hard. So that has been a huge part of my life, because I think through that process, I started to see a lot of other areas of my life that I wanted to keep moving forward in and improving. And I didn't, in active addiction, yeah. I didn't really see any of that. I was just kind of day to day and barely getting through. And also the facade that, you know, you have to present if you are you know, drinking, I was raising children and I had a corporate job, and like looking at me from the outside, it would be like, what,
you know, like everything's going great.
Got it together.
Did you retain your little bit of pretentious Italian accent? Like, did you, I mean,
that is a great question.
Did you keep that?
Heck yes. Yeah.
Okay.
I had a lot of tools. I mean,
I'm not hearing it, but
it was not an accent, but it's more of like the words and the, you know, like
the way you did it.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of people that came out of the uptown area in the 90s have made that decision. Like, you know what? Yeah, that was enough.
Well, and I would love to, you've probably talked about this then.
Yeah, so I did a TEDx talk October of 2022.
Jeez, if we did any research, we'd know this.
Yeah, well, that's why we're here. We're getting to know each other,
exactly.
Right? That was huge, because I really am on the more introverted side. And if you would have told me 10 years ago that I would be on a stage and looking in our comedy corner underground location, looking like red carpet on a stage, telling people, I use the word alcoholic because that's what I said in the beginning when I got sober. I don't identify with that term as much anymore.
Yeah. Ooh, I want to get into that.
Yeah, so do I. We can totally do that. But 10 years ago, that was it. It was like, it kept me out of the rooms. I knew I needed help.
Yeah.
But I wasn't ready to like step into a room of strangers and just be like, I'm Jen and I'm an alcoholic.
Right. Like the one thing we have here.
Yeah. Yeah. So that has been one of the key things that I tell a lot in my story. I talk about not having to say that and just all the different ways you can access sobriety right now.
Well, yeah.
I would like to just throw out there, to me, I mean, owning your stuff, great.
Yeah.
But there feels like a little bit of shame and connotation integrated into like, hi, my name is this.
Yeah.
I'm an alcoholic.
It defines you. Oh, it's putting a label on yourself.
You're in one basket and you're trapped in there forever.
And you have character defects, and we're going to revisit them every single meeting, like, and you're going to carry that weight forever.
No. I hope you're ready to carry all the shame. Like, I don't, that doesn't feel like healing to me.
I really feel like it's been moving away from that, which is
I think
good.
It's pretty uniquely American.
It worked
American
for someone.
It did. And
it worked for a lot of people.
It does. Yes.
But
it's weird. It's like it's not for everybody.
You know, and the thing that we've had through the work on the tech side of my life, we've had various sober agencies come in and want to sort of explore the idea of using our tech, right? So like AA specifically.
Yeah.
Because you spin these things up. You spin these meetings up, and AA is really about a book.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not, there's not really a centralized organization telling everyone to do it.
Right.
Right. And then there's like Sober Squad, which is a Native American version of this, which I have a lot of respect for what they're doing.
Yep.
But I think about it in, like, I'm not an expert by any means on any of the different parts of it. But yes, America went down this path of, you're either this or you're not.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everybody's in the same group. Whereas most of the Europeans that I've met throughout time are like, that one drinks way too much.
That's too much.
This one's got a little bit of this in them, and they act like a dick when they're drunk.
It doesn't work for you? Well, then cool, don't do it.
And then these people,
absolutely.
You know, let loose every now and again, and that one does. Like, there's like 50 different categories.
Absolutely, on a spectrum.
Yes, it's a total spectrum.
Completely. Yeah. Well, and interestingly enough, when I was in Italy, so that, you know, I was, 20 when I went there, I was like, sweet, I can drink as much as I want. I'm away from home and drinking culture and wine, obviously, there.
Totally.
I did not drink there.
No.
Which
Because it's not about... It
surprises me.
That's not the culture. It's not about just going out drinking. It's not the culture.
And that's what pointed out to me that there is such a cultural difference. And then also like the need to change our cultural spaces here in America so they don't centralize on alcohol.
Look at us though.
Because you don't feel like you have any other options. Right. And that's what I've built my two new businesses really around is working on... having integrated experiences. We're sitting here. Yeah. This doesn't bother me in the least bit that, you know, you're enjoying an alcoholic beverage, right? But like that can be very triggering for people early in sobriety. Yes. And there's
but
not
in the
an
absence of
option,
integrated
right?
experiences,
mm-hmm. yeah.
you've got a us and them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the us and them is not it's not good for everybody.
It's not good.
Right, like there needs to be space for that integrated experience because you're not unfun because you're not having a drink.
No,
like,
exactly.
Right.
I worry that because we gauge time by the light.
Yeah. Well, we that's do. What we do. That's what we do. Our
by
first
the bottle. Bottle. Yes.
That's what we do.
But you know, to be fair.
Yeah.
And some shows they'll be like, oh, we're gonna have shots and do this, mm-hmm. and you know, it's total and wine and crime stuff, and it's like total drinking culture.
Mm-hmm.
I worry sometimes, like, we're not trying to promote drinking.
Mm-hmm. No.
But, and I'm not saying that you're the best gauge of time that there ever was in the whole world is a bottle of beer.
No, yeah, how long it takes you to typically drink a bottle and
we
sip
have
but
a,
it kind of came about organically for what we've been doing.
Yeah.
Like, well, just like, well, yeah, this that's about the right amount of time.
Something
right.
that I learned.
Take a break? Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And it's something that I learned kind of in Germany is, like, there is truth. Like, we're going to lighten up a little bit. More mm-hmm. like the conversation is going to get a little easier to have if we have the couple of beers, but it's not about the drinking. And if you don't, you can still participate and enjoy yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I worry, like, we don't want to promote it.
No.
But we acknowledge
that it happens. Well, it's like when you're sitting around, how this is, you're sitting around a campfire, there'd be a natural break where you're like, oh, can I grab you something? You get up. That's a natural thing that happens.
And if you're sitting around a campfire having a good conversation, do you really care whether the people you're having the conversation with are
never.
Drinking THC beverages, smoking the pot, having
having
Minnesota alcohol,
soda.
Or having nothing, and are all still part of the conversation.
Right. Yeah,
all of those things work.
Yeah.
Everybody knows
the reality of the social experience today.
Yes.
Yeah.
And in fact, the person who's getting too drunk is the person you probably don't want there anymore.
Yeah, but here's the other thing: why should the person who wants to be sober have to miss out on
they shouldn't
fun
really
thing?
Race
and if you are comfortable handling that,
And how can we support people to get more comfortable in this?
More than one way.
Is that what you're doing?
Well, yes, because the question, why aren't you drinking, came up any time I wouldn't, you know.
It's rude.
It got really annoying for many, many years. And I just was tired of answering, being asked the question, but also didn't have like a fun non-alcoholic beverage to have in my hand so that people wouldn't ask because... Yeah. Now, in the last 4 or 5 years, that has come along.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't know if I had, you know, a fancy little drink here. It would be like, no questions asked. And I would be the same fun, engaging person.
Yes. Yep.
And then that barrier would just be. So it really is about kind of this belonging. Like, you guys could have said, oh, you're not drinking? Like, come on, have a beer with us, right? And you didn't do that.
No.
But that happens. And people just get tired of having to answer for that and will default to what's there.
Right.
So my mission is to get more of these.
I feel like it's moved away from
spaces.
That now. It's like there's so many other options.
Yeah.
People understand it's like it's not for everybody. If you don't drink, I don't really care.
I think
there are more options now. You can still be social. You don't have to have that feel like you're put out of the group or something like, well, I don't want to have a beer. Well, okay, great.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine. Yeah. There's other things.
And I think the shift that needed to happen is more cultural than anything else.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because the idea, there's something weird about, let's say you show up somewhere and everybody's drinking and you're not, and then you take a beer bottle or something and you put something in it that looks like beer, you're bending yourself to conform to their concept. This is true in race 100%. Race stuff too.
Yeah.
You know, like, don't make me fucking change myself and explain to you why I'm not doing that. Can I just be here and be a person and be seen as a person and not the, you know, so.
Instead of being introduced at a party, like, bookended by, and they don't drink.
Right.
Yeah.
That's
always
fun.
Yeah. Like, okay. Thanks for making it awkward.
Yeah.
But it almost feels like the the fake drink was the bridge that was maybe necessary.
We do, yeah, to get to whatever that point. Is necessary. Yeah. I mean, especially we hear from like pregnant women. That's one I hear from all the time. Like they don't want to tell anyone they're not drinking. So they're always secretly ordering something and in a big group that's alcoholic and then catching the, you know, server on the side to say. Oh, yeah. And that happens a lot in the industry with wine, people, you know, connoisseurs of wine, like having to like taste all these beverages and put up a pretense that they're indulging in alcohol in order to sell it or whatever is everywhere. I hear stories all the time.
Oh, yeah.
We hear it from musicians that come on the show, too. That 100%. Sorry, we can't pay you tonight, but the bar tab is free. Yeah. It's like, great, but what if I don't drink?
And corporate gifting. I mean, there's so many angles.
Can you cover my parking?
Like, you're just, it's just put in your face, like, all the time. Constantly. And it's like, oh, this is exhausting. I have to say no. And I mean, just, I really don't want to see it. And I just.
But you want to be out and do things.
Yeah. And you want to be out and experience. That's the other thing with, you know, Minnesota here, we have Hazelden. We have a huge recovery community.
We do.
But a lot of times people in recovery aren't necessarily the ones asking for all these NA options. It's more of this middle area that we're starting to see come along. And especially with Gen Z who are just like, I mean, my kids are just like, what were you doing?
Yeah, my kids have no interest. Like, they're like, I don't care.
Isn't it funny that those damn kids.
They're just smarter than us.
The bulk of our audience. Yes, but they can look at you and they're like, wait a minute. So you guys did what sort of fucked up crap in the past so that you could, wait a minute, you
in a cornfield.
Used to feel like you needed to conform so you would scrunch your bits in this or do that or beat someone up because they didn't quite conform. Yeah, like
what?
Yeah,
you guys were idiots.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. We did go through a lot of work to be a part of something.
We're not. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And then we had, closeted friends who couldn't tell the whole world. They didn't. And in fact, do they have to tell? Who gives a shit?
They shouldn't have to.
Just leave them alone.
Let
them do their thing.
Let them be.
You know? And the kids these days get that, and all of us who grew up in a certain era, I guess, you know, and it was probably worse before our era. I would like to think that these things have been getting better.
Side effects of bullies.
We're the bridge from back then to now, I guess, right?
Yeah.
But I mean, the drinking thing, it's such a massive part of the culture. But the kids seem to be like. Oh, no, we're not going to let that be a thing anymore.
No.
Yeah.
We're not
going to
worry about it.
Now they're like, you could care less.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Not to say that they're not still having problems with it. Not to say that there aren't still issues out there in the world.
Right.
But they're overall, in my estimation, they're acting more like the Germans that I lived with who just were like, why do you guys make such a big deal out of this shit all the time? Like, just don't drink and drive. Mm-hmm. And if you're an asshole, I'm going to tell you the next day you were really drunk and you were stupid last night.
Jerk.
Don't do that anymore, please. Or I just won't hang out with you.
But anyway. There's a lot of denial in the, you know, just like that didn't happen last night or no one wants to acknowledge that or have a conversation, which is surprising to me that only a handful of people over probably 20 years of alcohol misuse actually talk to me about it.
Yeah.
And I had family and friends that, you know, would witness me being very drunk. But, she's why? Because they see me the next day and I'm up doing a workout. I'm up, you know, like
living on with your life.
Functional. And like in the inside.
Doing the daily duties.
Yeah.
Okay.
So people don't
want to call it out. It took me a second to understand what you were saying.
She must be fine.
She went to work. The kids
she's
got to school.
Under control.
Like there's
totally
dinner on the table.
Everything's great.
Right. The functioning part of all of that.
Which is the most confusing part.
And it's sometimes, you know what? The easiest thing to hide is misery.
So you're, it took me just a second there to figure out what you had said. Mm-hmm. I just want clarity. So you're saying that there, the times that you overindulged or misused alcohol in some way, people would sort of protect that situation by just not really acknowledging.
Helping me kind of cover it up, kind of laughing it off. And I'd be like, I guess it's not that bad. So just perpetuating.
And was it happening sort of regularly?
It looks so different over two decades.
Sure. That makes sense.
It's like.
That's the spectrum.
It is.
Yeah.
And that's the confusing part. Cause when I was pregnant, I didn't drink at all.
Mm-hmm.
And I had great pregnancies and I loved being sober, but everyone kept saying toward the end, okay, wait till you get that.
Yeah,
exactly. Oh, for sure.
What's your first drink going to be? Oh. And I was already assuming that I would go back to it where I didn't even pause to say, that was amazing.
Yeah.
Like, I felt amazing. I was sleepy. I mean, not many pregnant women. It was like the best time of their lives. But wow, I've been reflecting on that lately. And it's just, it's so ingrained in culture that it's hard to get away from.
Yeah. I think it was. I feel that we're in a much better place now, that it's not the same, that it's not as ingrained. From when you see people coming up now, people going out to bars, they don't know how to order a drink. They don't know how to, it's not a natural part of the culture as much.
No, it's definitely still ingrained in people our age.
Well,
we're slow
learners, let's be honest.
And it would be hard pressed to say that I haven't had too much to drink in my lifetime or something.
Yeah,
like I can own that. But I've always looked at it like for me, I would like for drinking always to be sort of a social and I'm having fun kind of thing.
Yeah.
And if there's a darker, uglier element to it, I sort of turn away from it. So like if I'm getting more depressed, I would tend to drink less.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And if I'm having more fun and hanging out with people, it's totally social for me. I'm like, come on over. We're having a campfire.
Yep.
Like I like to talk and hang out with people. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't always have to be that. But I you know, if anyone listening is like, but Sam fucking drinks. Like, yes, there is. I'm not denying that. But I have since my youth, and then like I didn't drink in high school. I didn't drink purposefully until I was 18. It was a conscious decision. Most everybody else around me was drinking. My buddy Josh, who you know, good old Josh Constant. The first time we drank, and we had been friends for many years, was my 18th birthday up on Mille Lacs Lake. And we did that
fucking
purposely
fish house.
Because I wanted to – because I wanted to know what it was, but I didn't want to get into the trouble that I saw previous family, you know, like my aunts and uncles mostly. Right. Like don't want to call any of my aunts out there. Great. But
they'll smack you.
I saw the problems it could cause.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And I thought, well, I should probably make it through high school before I...
At least you have that inkling.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, right. Like you put some thought into your own decision making then.
Yes.
Instead of just like, all right,
not everyone did
somebody
that.
Got a bottle from their dad and we're just going to do it till the sun comes up and the bottle's empty.
We'll get back to you two in a second.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wow.
Oh, sorry, for
no,
it's about you.
No. I mean, my thoughts on certain aspects of your influence on me is what I'm talking about. Okay. But anyway, and then I was in Germany. So then I drank. And yes, my family, we've got a long history of liking drinking. And I understand that, right?
Yeah.
And that's a cultural thing. And there's two different sides of the family. One's Germans, one's Irish. So there's going to be some drinking. You know, but then I lived in Germany and I got taught some of the other ways that you can approach alcohol.
Right.
Like how that works and what it means.
It can be a celebration. It can be a good thing. It's not just every night of the week, this is what I do.
Well, I mean, it's always scared me. So we've lost several friends from Filio.
Yep.
Who, my good friend Glenn, I'll just put it out there because I've already talked about it before. Yeah. But my good friend Glenn, you know, about 9 months before he died, I was at his house and I'm like, I know you're going to die, Glenn, if you don't stop drinking. Yeah. Like, this is just a really big problem.
Yeah.
And you're a good person and you just need help. And if you don't get the help, and he refused, you know.
But you talked to him about it.
Yeah.
And I've talked to other friends of ours from Filio who died from drinking as well. And this guy, Mark, has been a restaurant person forever and gets given alcohol by people. I've never really seen him struggle with the drinking. Yeah. Kate, you've always been at the parties and you've drank responsibly most of your life from what I can tell. Does that mean that sometimes you haven't let yourself loose a little bit here or there or whatever?
Yeah,
like
of course.
And done the wrong thing maybe one night or here or whatever, like Drew.
But it's kind of like, it's not one thing for it. What works for one person doesn't work for another. Some people should be in relationships. Some shouldn't. Some people should be married. Some people shouldn't.
Sure.
Some people should drink. Some people shouldn't. Everybody's different. It's like you find what works for you.
Yeah.
I mean, one of my best friends from high school was sober He's always been sober, never did anything while the rest of us were doing it. He never did.
Yep.
It's just kind of, it's like it worked for him.
And he's, so
it
was great. He lives in the palace and he's, I'm just I do feel like there is some, if I look back in life, I'm like, damn it, there's probably a lot of things I could have gotten done that I didn't get done.
He just never did.
Yeah. But at the same time, there's a lot of experiences and a lot of things that I, so you were talking about like, okay, so you did something wrong one night or whatever. Yeah. And then, but everyone's looking at you, and the next day you've got this corporate job and you're successful, and so they're not necessarily seeing the like internal struggle.
Yeah. No one's seeing that.
They're not seeing the downside. For
they're thinking because of why X isn't a problem or something. Yeah. And you're like, but X is actually a problem.
Yeah.
And because I have the job doesn't mean I'm
doesn't and it mean all I'm falls healthy. Apart eventually if you continue at that pace. It's just not sustainable, I found.
No, it's and you were struggling with it badly enough that you needed to stop entirely.
Yeah. And it's a very isolating experience too. And I think that's what's changed in terms of people getting help is that it's understood even more so now that it's more, it can be family and friends, like can be involved in the healing and the help. Mm-hmm. So I kind of isolated myself and was like, I'm just going to go to the AA meetings and deal with this on my own.
Oh, it's totally old school. Yeah.
And not talk with my family about it. Not, you know, it's
because of the shame or embarrassment.
Yeah, it's still shameful. And that's,
are you still feeling shame?
So about 3 years into AA, I was like, you know, it served its purpose beautifully because it is so hardcore. Like there's just no,
there's a time,
there's no gray area.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And you need it out of a certain world into a different world.
It works for a lot of people. Yep. And I accepted that for what the program was able to do for me. But once I hit a certain point where I was just opened to the amazingness of a sober lifestyle without ever having to think, am I going to have a drink tonight? Like calculating all this, it just was off the table.
Right.
And it was just this lifted like experience of not having to think about that anymore. When my entire life up to that point had always been like, am I going to get so wasted tonight? I'm going to black out and not remember. Like that's terrifying. It's terrifying at the end of addiction to be like, you just feel like you have no control over anything. So to be free of that is why people just protect their sobriety so fiercely.
Yeah.
And then it started looking different. I'm like, this life is amazing.
Yeah.
And it should be celebrated for the hard, you know, the hard work and the intention behind it. But no one was really doing that in a way that I truly like releasing that shame, like being able to like sit in front of a corporate room now. And I say, yeah, I definitely had a drinking problem for years. And when I do that, I have women come up and be like, I've never heard anyone say that.
But you should.
Like that's why I'm doing the work that I'm doing, because I want to empower others to be able to do that and reclaim.
What you did was difficult.
Yeah.
It was intentional.
Mm-hmm.
And every day it was work.
Mm-hmm.
And you did it. Mm-hmm. That should be celebrated.
Yeah, it should be.
That's a personal accomplishment that everyone should go, fuck yeah.
Well, but I'm pushing back slightly.
Okay.
Because it's it's all good. I mean, that's the role of these conversations or whatever, is just to talk about it. But the celebrating of it, I think so for people, so it is a spectrum. The drinking part's a spectrum.
Right.
And so it's easy enough to get caught up in this sort of like, okay, well, I'm sorry to hear that you had so many problems with it. I don't have those same problems. Or to feel like now all of the people who used to drink and still might talk about how fun times were or the cool shit they did when they were drinking, not all the bad stuff, but now they've created a club whereby those of us who still drink, we have to feel guilty if we hang out with them.
Right.
Like it's kind of got to be a two-way street because honestly, it's beneficial for me to hang out around sober people.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
And it's beneficial for me to be around people who can drink responsibly.
That's right.
And I love that. And I feel like I'm one of, I don't know how many people
I
truly
would like
in sobriety
to see that brought forward.
Yes. Yeah. And I'm at a point now, almost 10 years in, I might not have said that year one because I'm still upset about the fact that I can't go out.
Yes.
But at some point,
you
that
lost
changes.
Something in the process.
I did.
Some part of yourself, it's like losing your anxiety.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like your best friend that you hate and they hate you, but you love each other. You're codependent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They make the horrible suggestions that are fun.
Yeah.
But they're still horrible suggestions.
Yeah. Your anxiety buddy is telling you how. Like the inner voice that's like beating you down and telling you bad things. People have a hard time giving that one up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they have a hard time giving up the drinking because it's the thing that calms you at the end of the day.
Sure,
right, whatever.
Yeah.
And then it's the thing that also makes you lose your mind and not remember what you did.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Like, oh, you're a dick. You were good for about 15 minutes, but then you were a dick.
Yeah.
Like,
the other part took over.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so
it's finding those things to replace it and things you do that you're like, okay, I enjoy this and I enjoy this.
Well, but I like the way the conversation is going about because there's some part of AA or people who've been through the process where it felt like you're creating an us versus them situation. You're either part of my tribe or you're part of the drinking tribe, right? Mm-hmm. Like sober tribe, drinking tribe. And like the more you can bring that together where it's like, okay, but if there's a spectrum, can we mingle in the middle? Like I get it. The extreme, I'll never drink. And I think alcohol is evil. People probably don't want to hang out with me.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know?
Yeah, right.
And you're probably not looking to hang out with them.
No,
it's a mutual thing.
I get it.
But there's so much in the middle. There should be so
that
much.
That middle part is I think you're
but
like,
it's an
you're
acceptance
healing
from both sides. Mm-hmm. If someone doesn't want to drink, it'd be like, oh, come on. It's like, well, no.
No, don't do that.
Don't
do that. And then you've
don't
got
do
the,
that.
Yeah, don't, that's yeah.
The, then
no.
You've got the friend who's like, you know, still wanting to do keg stands at 55 years old or whatever, right? And you're like, no,
don't
those days
do
are
that.
You need to stop.
Either
that's got to do with drinking that you hurting yourself.
You know, it's not dissimilar to the conversation we had with Lance about the weed too.
Right. Yeah.
Yep. I've got friends who started smoking pot, and it's like their entire life became consumed with the discussion of pot and weed and the consumption of it, you know, so it's, we need to talk about it and do it all the time. And I'm like, well, I don't think I've seen you sober in, God knows how long.
Right.
And they're like, yeah, but you drink. And like, but you've seen me sober. But if you've got the friend who drinks and you're like, I don't think I've seen you sober in years, same thing. You're like, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Whatever
too much
the
of anything isn't good. Right. It's the term mindful, right? And intention in the younger generation.
I trip over to
using that all the time and thinking
they're
about
it. They're good at it.
Mm-hmm.
I trip over it because I'm like, I don't know, when am I not being mindful?
And it's tied in ritual too. You know, I think that's an important thing. And that's a lot of what we talk about, looking at those rituals. And is it really the alcohol, or is it just that you have a drink in hand and you're in community and you have that experience,
That experience.
So if you can start to understand that there might be some environments where you're like, I could go either way. And my best times are with friends that maybe have an alcoholic drink to start out the night and then they switch to NA and it's never a thing. It's not like, oh, are you okay if I have this alcoholic beverage?
I mean, until you said that.
I'm just like, rude.
Please. Yeah, that part of it needs to just be done.
That needs to be done. And people
you
do
worry
mean
about
well.
You.
Yeah. But
of course they mean well, but we did all sorts of negative, harmful stuff meaning well.
Right.
Like,
right.
I mean, All right. Now I understand. It was funny because I think when Glenn recommended that you be on the show, I like I said, we don't do research, right? But there was some tiny portion of it.
So much.
Well, there's been a couple of things. We had Susanna.
Yep.
What's her last name?
No.
We had Susanna
on. Don't
hurt
yourself because I'm not going to help.
You're the worst.
Absolutely horrible.
Newell. So Susanna Newell talked about – oh, listen to the chairs upstairs.
Yeah, that's right.
About vaccines.
Oh, yes.
And being harmed by vaccines.
I wasn't here.
You were here.
That's why I was like, I can't help.
Yes. Anyway, so yes. she talked about vaccines and being harmed by vaccines. And before having Susanna on, there was a part of me that like, oh, I don't want to put an anti-vaxxer weirdo on the show.
Too late.
No, she just was kidding. Great. Because
that's not what it was. She was great. Because
no, you should be able
to. I know.
I was I
know.
Talking about myself.
I'm serious, though. Yeah.
But it's like you should be able to. Every conversation's on the table. You should be able to.
I don't know what
everything.
I'm going to get into with this. Right. She comes on. She's wonderful.
Awesome.
Such a nice mm-hmm. woman. Yeah. She's got a. She's smart. She's articulate. Yeah. She's telling a story that needs to be told. Yep. We had a great conversation. We had Tyler Moon on. Who clearly wanted to promote his ministry. No, he comes on the show and he's just talking to us. And
I don't think that came up till the end. We're like, wait, what?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, because it's not, you're not just one thing. Weird.
And so when you hear, so I think Glenn had said something about have Jen on the show, but it's about, she's doing something with sobriety. Like he gave me just a little blurb, you know? And I was like, okay. You know, we'll see.
Great.
I don't know how that works, but this was really fun, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and sauna and sobriety is the thing that I'm doing that kind of converges the idea of a social experience that is not centralized around alcohol and showing people that you can have these intimate, great connections without drinking.
Yeah.
So, you don't, as much as I love the alcohol myself, you don't need the drink.
You don't.
Yeah. Like, no. Well, other thing is, I think when you get in where are you going to go in a sauna?
That's a big part of the experience.
And
you're uncomfortable.
Well, you're in there with a couple of people. It's quiet. It's comfortable. You're going to find stuff to talk about and you're going to start to connect.
Yes.
And that's when the magic happens.
Magic.
Am I wrong?
Mm-hmm. I don't really know, but I think clearly the culture needs to shift and it seems like it is to the point where the Germans had it where you can drink, you cannot drink, and you can hang out and everyone still gets along.
No one
cares.
No one cares.
They just did not make a big deal out of they. I never once heard anyone say like, oh, she's not drinking. That's a bad thing, you know, or like you need to drink with us. Mm-hmm. Like it, you just give that shit up.
Yeah.
Like worrying about what the other person is doing as an outside influence affecting your enjoyment of the evening. Like, just enjoy your evening or don't enjoy your evening.
Get over it.
It's not really up to you what they do.
Right.
And it doesn't affect you.
And you don't need to worry about it.
How about mind your business?
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Just a small slice of...
But it makes people uncomfortable. And that's in America. And that's why.
It'll get to the point where it doesn't.
Right?
Eventually.
Certainly hope so.
Well, because of work, like the work you're doing. No, I mean,
I don't really know the work you're doing. Well, there's a couple of things. So Zero Proof Collective is coming up on 2 years that my co-founder Kate and I have been at this, but we are trying to be advocates for the movement, but also describe what does an elevated non-alcoholic cocktail look like? What does it look like to have it on a menu and then serve it with some sort of excitement about it? Not just like, oh, you need it, you know, like on the side. Yeah. Again, it contributing to the shame.
Yeah.
So it is, it's a mission for sure to, and actually what I've heard is Minneapolis is really on the forefront of this compared to the coast. So we have people all the time that will be like, you know, go out
mocktails.
East or whatever. And they exist, but they exist in more isolated spaces.
Yeah,
whereas
fringe.
Here, they're a little more starting to be integrated.
I feel like they're more and more everywhere. I don't know that I would classify them as fringe anymore.
Not at all.
Yeah.
I like it,
which is great.
Yeah.
And honestly, any bartender will, even if you're in a restaurant, like they will gladly make you whatever you want.
It just takes normalizing it.
They also don't know how, a lot of them, you would think, right? But it's, again, it's if you try to order something NA, it's not on the menu and you have to have this long conversation. Right. And then the bartender's like, well, what do you think you want? And then you get it and it's not what you want and you're still paying. There's a lot of room there because, again, it just feels... Like if you were, if your experience was valued, they would have the NA stuff exactly with all the ingredients on the menu. Mm-hmm. And then there's a lot of questions about what is alcohol free. And then there's low alcohol.
Right.
There's no. So just, and also some bartenders just don't have the experience of tasting all the amazing non-alcoholic distilled spirits out there. Yeah. Like, who's going to go get an education on what's available? So that's where we're kind of inserting ourselves as experts and helping those bars and restaurants identify.
Someone who's interested in diversifying their menu for the sake of happy customers would be a good place to start.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's
are you in the hospitality industry or aren't you?
Exactly.
Well, I mean, it's just definitely becoming – it's a growing part of what's available.
And I like that it's becoming more just a natural thing. You don't see it and be like, oh, that's weird. It's like, oh, yeah, okay.
Right,
You're starting to expect to see
you're just,
it.
Yeah. You're changing. Yeah. Cultural change takes takes time.
Yeah.
It does.
Well, I always laugh. I still like go to places that have like 85 bottles of wine on the menu, but like not even one non-alcoholic wine. And the NA wines are starting to get so much better. Yeah. It's like just that's all we're asking, just an option.
And
we're
not going to
overtake or take alcohol away.
Is also the industry is starting to get into it because before there weren't a lot of options. If you wanted any beer, there was the one.
That's, that was 5 years ago. I was at the point of frustration because there was never anything that I could say, this is what I want. And now I can say that.
Yeah, you're like, oh, you have these three options for this for that. I mean, there's so many more options. The industry has finally figured out. You know, before, there was like maybe one or two types of alcohol-free wines. O'Doul's
just like what I asked upstairs.
That was it. That's all there is. Yeah. But now it's like, oh, I've got this.
O'Doul's Amber is not bad.
It's really the one it's drinkable.
Yeah.
That's the market demanding it. And
there's a convergence in the middle. So we always tell people, ask for NA and, a kind way. Don't be like, where's... Yeah. But like, having consumers ask for it makes a huge impact on then bars and restaurants saying, I guess people will pay for this and they want that and we need to pay attention.
Yeah, which is true.
All right, Jen. We're 40 some minutes into the second half already.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to do the third half here after.
We'll have you back in a while to talk about the kind of state of where this is headed and all that. So
that would be lovely. Yeah.
I really appreciate you coming in and trusting us to walk down those stairs and do this.
Yeah. I love that there was no prep work.
Yeah. Isn't that the best part? Like, what are the questions? We don't know what the questions are.
We don't know yet.
What's going to happen with the interview? We don't know. It doesn't matter.
You know more than we do. Yeah. You know your name. That's more than we have.
Just thanks a lot.
Absolutely. Awesome. It's been fun. I love talking about all this and exploring where people are at.
Everyone says that. Yeah. Everyone says that. I'm not sure it's true.
Okay. Yeah.
We'll find out if it's really fun or not. I'm just saying.
I had fun. I don't care. I'm good.
I mean, I had fun too, but I just, is there anything you want to promote? You have a TED Talk out there.
I mean, I think
don't want to close too soon.
Yeah. I think I mentioned Zero Proof Collective, which is, the NA movement. So zeroproofcollective.com. You can look at all the media and the stories, and then Sauna and Sobriety really is what we think is what I feel like needs to be done is we can't just say, social spaces need to change and then...
No, you need to build
You need to model how that's done. So the Sauna and Sobriety piece is one way to invite people in who are sober because I got a lot of pushback on the name and I'm like, nope. I'm keeping that in there because there's nothing outside of AA that intentionally says you are welcome here. Because usually you'd have to go through and look at restaurant menu. You'd have to figure out if you would fit in.
Yeah.
And decide.
Which you shouldn't have to do.
And so this is just a place where you come and the base level is just nope. And that actually makes a huge difference in the experience. Yeah. If no one is having any sort of substance and you watch the connections happen, to me that's proof.
The pressure's off then.
Versus like an integrated experience, which just feels different. Yep. So. There's all of those are possible.
Well, we will and we will link to all of those things in all of the show notes and stuff like that. So like if you're just listening and you're curious about this,
check it out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Jen Gilhoi, this day and age people will find the info.
Oh,
they will.
Yeah. It's all good.
That's amazing.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank
very,
you
very
all.
Much.
It's been fun.
All right.
Cool.
Well, you did it. You made it to the end of another show. Thank you all so much for listening to our show. We really, really appreciate it. Don't forget to send us your questions, comments, or even your guest requests. Maybe you want to be a guest. Maybe you know someone who would be a great guest. Send them in to info@legacymatterspodcast.com. All right. See you next time.
theme music and all the other music that you've heard on this show is created by and recorded by the fabulous Captain Al. Check him out.